Today's podcast is brought to you by WarbyParker.com. Get a free 5-day home try-on at WarbyParkerTrial.com/David Feldman Show. 5 pairs, 5 days, 100% free.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
This is going to change your life. I swear to you. People who do my show get sucked into a vortex of need that they have to disconnect their phone. Do you know Neal Brennan? We're recording, by the way. What I do is I find young comics who remember me as a beautiful little comic from the, you know, 90s.
Sure.
And they look up to me, and then I just keep having them on my show over and over again until they feel trapped. That's what happened with Neal.
I feel trapped already, and this is my first time.
Didn't Neal Brennan say, "Will you do my podcast?" is the new, "Hey, can you drive me to the airport?"
Yeah, but we've actually expanded that to be, because so many people have their own TV shows now. My wife was saying that it's actually, "Will you appear on my TV show?" is the new, "Will you do my podcast?" which was the old, "Can you drive me to the airport?" That's how far we've come.
Yes. Moshe Kasher is a comedian and author of the 2012 memoir, Kasher and the Rye, The True Tale of a White Boy from Oakland Who Became a Drug Addict, Criminal, Mental Patient, and Then Turned 16. That's great.
It gives you all you need.
I owe you an apology. I just started reading the book, and I have not finished it yet, but I have a lot of questions to ask you. I never got around to it until I found out you were doing the show, and I'm beating myself up. I'm going, how dare I not have finished this? You also have a stand-up special on Netflix called Moshe Kasher, Live in Oakland. And
true.
Yes.
So it's on Hulu now, actually. We started on Netflix and we migrated over to Hulu.
All right. I got a lot of questions to ask you, young man.
Let's do it.
Okay.
You remember, by the way, David, the first time we met? Because I do.
Go ahead.
I was doing a guest spot for you at Rooster Teeth Feathers.
Yes.
I would say the primary chicken-themed comedy club in the United States of America. Probably the best one. Probably.
Well, and Heather, by the way, Heather runs a great club.
Yeah, cock-a-doodle-doo, she does.
Yeah.
It's a good club. It's where, in fact, the trivia about that place is it's where the world's first video game was placed. It was the bar that that Pong was placed, so that people for the first time ever could play video games at a bar.
Really?
But, yeah, that is true.
Wow.
And you were headlining, and I...
Are you saying what I was headlining when the world's first video game was being tested?
Yeah, you actually headlined the world's first video game. And I remember very distinctly that between the early and the late show, we had about a half an hour conversation where you really had a conversation with yourself where you were trying to convince me, you were vacillating between trying to convince me to change my name to a less Jewy name. And then you would argue with yourself. You would go, "Moshe, you can't go by Moshe. You have to change your name. Anti-Semitism will destroy..." You know what? No, Moshe, don't change your name. Don't change your name. You have to be true to who you are. No, I'm crazy. Change your name. Definitely, you have to change it. And I wasn't even really participating in the conversation.
I remember that. I remember it over a course of a few days, or maybe... I thought you were opening for me all week.
Maybe I was. Maybe that's right. That could be correct.
I think what happened was you came in, you said your name was Moshe Kasher. I didn't know you. I didn't know what you did. And I said, "Change your name." And then I saw your act. And I go, "This guy's fantastic. Don't change your name. You don't need to. You know, life is tough and we're a thick-necked people." And, you know, and it went back and forth. And I've been going back and forth about changing my name since I was named David Feldman. And let me ask you, who is Mark Kasher?
Well, Mark, and as it says in my book, Mark is my legal first name. My middle name is Moshe.
So you changed your name. You changed your name.
Yeah, no, I did. Well, it's a complicated story that I don't love talking about, but I'll talk about
it. If you don't want to talk about it, that's okay.
No, we can do it. I'm just saying
you opted for a very Jewish name.
Well, right? I guess that's true, technically. I mean, basically, I was raised by my mother, who divorced my father.
I'm going to get to that. I'm going to get to all that stuff. I got a lot of questions to ask you.
All right. Well, it's all connected to the name. I'll tell you later.
Okay. So you changed it. You know what I found out about, you know, the name is very important, by the way. You know, Anthony Weiner. There's a whole syndrome now where the name is the thing, which goes all the way back to Shakespeare and beyond. I mean, how you're named influences your character in a play and in life. And there's a lot to a name. You know, Mark Hirschhorn?
No.
He reviews comedy podcasts. I've known him for years. He used to book comedy in San Francisco, and he's good friends with Dana Carvey. And he used to have a job up in San Francisco for a company that named companies. He would come up with names.
He came
up with Masson Gill Douche.
Good for him, man.
He comes up with names. Like, you know, Haagen-Dazs is a made-up name. I don't think Haagen-Dazs is an old name, but it's a made-up name. Speaking of naming names, your mother was a communist?
My grandmother and my grandfather were both card-carrying members of the American Communist Party. Yes, not my mother.
I see. And I just thought I'd mention that. But we'll get back to that in a second. But here's the thing about changing names as opposed to naming names. Jews, when they moved to Israel, changed their name. Like, the biggest Jew of all Jews, Ariel Sharon, who, you know, Zionist, his real name was Schneerson, and he changed his name, or the family changed his name. When Jews move to Israel, it's a tradition to change your name to evoke something of the land, as opposed to
something Hebraic. Yeah, I know what you mean. My friend, his last name is Weintraub. And then he moved to Israel, and he changed his name to Geffen. And then he decided Israel wasn't for him. He came back. He changed his name to Weintraub again. He re-nebuchized himself. But in the tradition of Geffens everywhere, he does have sex with underage boys pretty much constantly. So
yes, you know, I had the guests on my show, the director of the documentary A Known Secret, which it's a documentary about pedophilia in Hollywood.
You were great in that, by the way.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
I mean, it wasn't a sympathetic picture, but I really, you had a lot of humanity. I really got what you were saying.
And the person whose name you just mentioned was listed in the movie along with Ariana Huffington's husband, who go to boy parties.
Right. I've heard such things. I'm sure they're not true.
It's in the movie. It's in the movie.
It's in the movie. Yeah. I'm not saying it, but the movie.
I just thought I'd bring that up. And that's, you know, going up against some real power there. Not Ariana Huffington's husband. Well, maybe. Hey, so, yeah, you would think Jews in Israel would go with Weintraub, right? Because that's where it's safe to be a Jew. You'd think it'd be reverse, right?
Well, the whole thing about Israel, leaving aside all the trappings of the other side of politics there, is that Israel, its whole thing was like, post-Holocaust, was like trying to slough off that nebbishy, you know, weak victim, sheep to the wolves of society image of the Jew. And so people move to Israel and they think, you know, I don't want to be this little like asthmatic nerd anymore. I want to be this tough, Sabra, soldier. So what's in a name, right? Everything. So they changed their names to Barack and Ariel Sharon and things like that in the hopes that the image of the world would catch on. And it did. It worked, right?
Well, in a way, I've wrestled with this because I was raised to believe that there are two types of Jews. There's the one who goes into the oven and the one who fights back. And I've come to realize as I've gotten older that it's in all of us, that I'm the Jew who gets marched into an oven and the Jew who fights back. It's in all of us, and we wrestle right with this all the time. Am I the Jew who's going to fight, or am I the Jew who's going to take it? Although I do know some Jews who just fight.
Yes. Am I the Jew? Yeah, there's three kinds of Jews. The Jews who go to the oven, the one that fights, and the one that argues with the Germans. Tries to negotiate a peaceful release. No, but, you know,
They would go like, why are you putting three in the oven? You could put four, and you could save money on the heat. Go ahead.
I would say that, no, not only is there every kind of, both kinds of Jews in us, but unfortunately, and I think this is the thing that most people don't want to admit, even deeper, is that there's also probably the German in you, too. You know, there's the Jew that goes in the oven, the Jew that fights back, and then there's the German that sits there while people and their neighbors are being destroyed and killed. Like, unfortunately, there's all of that in all of us.
Yeah.
I think. Yeah. And there's another really stark passage in Viktor Frankl's Man's Search for Meaning. Have you read that book?
No. I don't even know who Viktor Frankl is.
Viktor Frankl was a Holocaust survivor who then went on to become a very famous psychiatrist. And he wrote a book, a famous book called Man's Search for Meaning, that was about his sort of psychiatry and his psychological analysis of people through the lens of his experience as a Holocaust survivor. And there's this really depressing passage in there, the only thing I remember from the book, where he says that basically in order to make it through the concentration camps, you had to be so cutthroat and selfish that the person that was sharing his bread with his neighbor was so sensitive that he would die, because you needed the whole heel of bread. You couldn't eat half a piece of bread and survive. That basically the only people that survived, he said that every survivor knows that the best of us perished in the camps, because it took a degree of selfishness and cutthroatness to make it through that kind of experience. It was just a very depressing picture of what it takes to survive, basically.
You know, I've thought about that. I didn't know that anybody ever dared to write about that, because I grew up with survivors, the children of survivors, and they were really messed up kids, and the parents were either haunted or aggressive. The women tended to be very quiet and shy. The fathers tended to be these really tough guys. You did not want to mess with them. And I often wondered about that. Like, what did you? There's the haunting eyes. What did you do to survive?
Right.
Do you ever wish you weren't born Jewish?
No, I've never wished that. No.
Yeah, I wish I wish you weren't born Jewish. So going back to Rooster Teeth Feathers. So I told you, I think we concluded that I was insane and you shouldn't listen to me.
Well, I was never going to change my name. That was what was funny about the whole thing to me, is I was just observing you, who I admired very much. And you're obviously we don't like throwing the L word around, but you know, people really, I really thought a lot of you comedically, and your reputation spoke for itself. But it was very interesting to watch this comedian who I admired so much have an argument with himself about what I should do. And I was, when I was never considering changing my name in the first place.
and you know, that's projection, I guess. I automatically assume, how could he not be wrestling with this?
I mean, well, I just, you know, what's really interesting, David, is like, I think right now we're dealing with, you're from a generation where Jewish people, you're probably the youngest person in the generation where Jewish people almost de facto would change their name.
Right.
And I think right now we're watching the last generation of gay people in show business pretend to be straight their mm-hmm. whole career. Like, I right. think that that doesn't have social currency anymore and doesn't really make sense. But I do think that there's people my age, maybe a little bit older, who are kind of the last generation of the gay comedian who will pretend his entire career to be straight. And right. younger gay comedians are like, why would I do that? That doesn't make sense. I'm not straight. You know what I'm saying? And
right.
it just, it has no currency for them. So I think we're kind of seeing both of those things happening.
Yeah, it is a generational thing. I'm 58. And so 1967, was that the Six-Day War? You weren't born yet, but you talk about the name changes and the guys who won't go into the ovens.
Exactly.
I'm old enough to remember the Six-Day War when the Jews had these very masculine Air Force pilots, and all, you know, my mother's friends and my sister were, who are these Jews? There are Jews
right,
like
exactly.
this? And they
the
were
six
like...
Day, the Six-Day War is classically, yeah, that's where the Nebbish Jew died. I mean, he lives again in the spirit of all American conservative Jews, but yeah, the yeah. Six-Day War is when they say all Jews looked and were like, wow, we can be tough, we can be cool, we can be... You know,
and it's interesting because my father went off and fought in World War II, came back and was a progressive liberal, Martin Luther King, you know, against the Vietnam War, didn't, you know, no gun in the house, all war is wrong. And a lot of the guys like, you know, the Sherman Brothers, did you ever see that documentary?
No, I don't think I did.
Anyway, a lot of the Jews who liberated the camps from America came back and just resumed to be, you know, they went off and fought and then resumed being Nebbishes when they came back to America.
That's kind of cool, actually.
I mean, it's just, it's, so are you a Nebbish?
I mean, I'm neither. You know, I was raised in Oakland, with my mother, and so I was, my primary cultural influence would not be American Judaism. It would be African American Oakland culture. So I was only really super Jewy 6 weeks a year. So I would say my primary cultural influencer would be hip hop culture and
yeah.
trying desperately to be black when I was,
yeah.
When I was young.
I got a lot to talk to you about that. I was watching you on Ari Shaffir's series. My first question, and I'm going to get to Jews, blacks, and what I call stolen valor.
Uh-huh.
I have a nephew who's Jewish who wants to be black, and I've accused him of stolen valor, which is a crime.
That's a very interesting comparison. Stolen valor is the thing where people pretend to be military accolades that they don't deserve, right?
Yes, yes. And when my nephew talks to me about what what he's been through, I, you know, take off your purple heart, my friend. But first, let me ask you.
That's interesting. It's like a culture war. You're stealing valor from the culture war.
Yeah, yeah. But let's get back to my line of questioning. Is Ari Shaffir is one of the funniest people I've ever met. He is one of the most daring comedians I've ever seen. If I hear he's on stage and I'm in the lobby, I'm running in to see what he's up to. My question for you, Moshe Kasher, is is he good for the Jews?
Is Ari good for the Jews? You know, I mean, God.
Is Ari Shaffir good for the
Jews? I'll tell you what I love about Ari's worldview, which I think is good for humanity and also bad for humanity, is, and in speaking about the Jew that is both the victim and the perpetrator and also the guy that fights back, is Ari is truly one of the only, like, active nihilists that I know. Like, I really think
And he has
does.
A similar upbringing to yours, correct?
Yeah, yeah. He went to yeshiva, yeah.
Okay,
yeah, he truly does not care does not care what people think and what about people's feelings. I couldn't say that for myself. I care what people think a lot. And so I don't know if he's good for the Jews, but I think he's probably good for society. I mean, anything that makes people uncomfortable, I think is probably good.
But when, okay, let me, because I'm older than you.
Yeah.
And, you know, Jews in show business police their own. You're aware of that, right?
That's interesting. Tell me more. I'm listening.
Well, the Jews in show business traditionally would not allow, like, they canceled the Goldbergs because it made them uncomfortable eventually. Not the show with Jeff Garlin. There was a show on in the early 50s called The Goldbergs, which was a very... Do you know about this show?
No, I don't.
Well, when I was growing up, my self-hating Jew... The self-hating Jews I knew were very ashamed of the Goldbergs, and they equated it with Amos and Andy.
Oh, sure.
And the network executives, who tended to be Jewish, quietly canceled the Goldbergs, even though it was popular, because it was ghetto, and Molly Goldberg kind of reinforced certain really sweet stereotypes about Jewish women and Jewish people and...
Did they give good head?
Well, yes.
What they were talking about in the 50s, right?
You know, I called Sarah Silverman when Bill Cosby was breaking. I said, here's a joke. Why don't you do it? You know, if you are so into women being lifeless during sex, why don't you go on J-Date? And she said, she goes, I'm not going to do that joke. That's an ugly stereotype about Jewish women. Jewish women are great in bed. Is that true that Jewish women are great in bed?
Well, I will tell you what the conventional wisdom is. Is that Jews are not as trapped by this idea of sexual original sin, so that they're not constantly like freaking out about like how dirty and slutty they are. And I would say that stereotype does hold true, that you don't find women racked with sexual guilt. They're busy being guilty about everything else, not calling their mothers and things like that. But sexual guilt, where you're filthy for being sexual, I would say is a uniquely Christian situation.
And what about blowjobs, though? The you know, Monica Lewinsky, notwithstanding, there was the stereotype when I was growing up. Maybe because it's not kosher, that good luck getting a Jewish woman to perform oral sex, but that's not really true, right?
Well, I lost you for a second there. Go back. You were saying Monica Lewinsky.
You're the luckiest person who's involved with the show right now. I said Monica Lewinsky, notwithstanding, Jewish women, the cliche is, the joke was, you know, Bill Clinton found the only Jewish woman who performs oral sex. That was one of the jokes that was going around at the time. But that's not really a fair stereotype, right?
I mean, I don't know. We should go out into the field and do some research, David.
Going back to policing our own. So when I asked you if Ari was good for the Jews, Ari Shaffir was good for the Jews, you know, Jews who work in show business traditionally have been very concerned about how Jews are represented in television and movies. Right?
Yeah, I guess that's true. You know, I have always been a person who feels that that poking fun at stereotypes by embodying them is only a good thing. You know, I do a lot of a lot of Jewish stuff in my act where, you know, I kind of lean into stereotypes in such an absurd way. Like I have a whole bit about how Jews ejaculate molten gold. I'm saying to that degree of like leaning into a stereotype, like. And I have been criticized by people going, oh, when you say things like that, it gives fuel to the fire of, you know, people's stereotypes about us. And I always feel just the opposite, that the racist stereotypes are so completely absurd that the best way to combat them is to say, oh, yeah, you know, yes, we do actually drink unbaptized Christian baby blood to make crackers. That shines a light on how absurd stereotypes about Jews and about every stereotype. I always say that white supremacists would be hilarious if they weren't every 6 months, you know, sort of incredibly dangerous. You know what I mean? like most 95% of racist stereotypes are so absurd to the point that they're actually humorous. And so I don't think anything's particularly off limits or bad for the Jews, because I think it just shows like how totally, you know, we're not a monolith, right? And so I think Ari and every other Jewish comedian that likes to lean into, you know, stereotype and the absurdity therein is actually probably good for society. I guess that's my thought.
Yeah, we're not a monolith. I was watching the documentary 13. It's on Netflix about the 13th Amendment. Kind of interesting. And one of the African Americans being interviewed said the civil rights movement gave black people the right to be complicated.
Right.
And I got the chills when I heard that. It just went, the right to be a complicated human being, not to be the friendly Negro, the magical Negro, the harmless Negro, the right to be a complicated, mentally ill African American who was off his meds one day and the cops shoot him. I mean, you know, the cops do not allow black men to be complicated.
That's exactly right. I mean, the whole idea of white panic, you know, the police brutality as a result of white panic about what black men are and represent is just that. It's that not only are black men and black women not allowed to be complicated internally, we like to think of them. And it's the same thing with Jews being either nerds or heroes. It's we like to think, and society likes to think of black people and Native Americans and every other person that we have oppressed and objectified as an idea rather than an individual. And so it makes it a lot easier to say, you know, that person's scary. Not that person is Thomas, and Thomas is having a bad day. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Blacks and Jews. One of the things that amazed me when I became 20 was that there was tension between blacks and Jews. I didn't know that. I grew up in a liberal, paternalistic household where my parents took pride in the Jewish participation in the civil rights movement. And, you know, without the Jews, there'd be no civil rights. And but it was paternalistic, and there was a lot of tension between blacks and Jews that I had no idea. And it was so complicated that I can remember Jesse Jackson, who I'm a huge fan of, in 1984, I believe. It might have been 88. Maybe it was 88. He was running for president, and he referred to New York as Heimy Town.
Right.
Remember, you might be too young to remember that.
No, it was offensive to Jews everywhere because we call it Kikeville, and we knew that you should have said that. Not okay.
And then it turns out his campaign manager was Jewish, you know, and that the two of them were referring to it as Heimy Town. And it's, you know, it's like we say to the blacks, what am I supposed to call you now? An Afro-American? What is it today? An African-American? Black? Colored? What is proper now? And Heimy Town, he honestly, I believe, didn't know that it was offensive. So blacks and Jews, you grew up in Oakland. The Black Panthers come from Oakland. It's God's country. I lived in Oakland. It's right next door to Berkeley. It is one of the most beautiful cities in the world. And it is also the original sin of San Francisco. It's the liberals are white and they live in San Francisco and they'll elect Willie Brown to be their mayor. He's African American. But across the bay is where we put the blacks. You won't find too many black people in San Francisco. It is really a city. They're, you know, limousine liberals. This is like the, you know, the limousine city for liberals, where you, if you want to see black people, you would go to Oakland. Is that a fair statement?
Oh, I would say it's more than fair. Yeah, there are two historically African American neighborhoods in San Francisco: the Fillmore and Hunter's Point. Hunter's Point is like kind of hilarious because...
Where's OJ from?
I think he's from Hunter's Point.
Yeah,
he's from Hunter's Point. And literally to get to Hunter's Point, you actually have to cross a bridge as within the city limits of San Francisco. It's like it couldn't be more metaphorically segregated, you know? Mm-hmm. But yeah, to get to a true and vibrant and large African-American community, you have to cross a bridge and get into Oakland, where you're the first person that's ever described as being one of the most beautiful cities in the world. But I agree. That's my hometown. I love it there. But
it's industrial.
It's industrial, and it's complicated, and Tower of Power's from there, and, you know, the Black Panthers and the Hell's Angels started there, and it's a complicated city, and I like the idea of it being the kind of original sin of the Bay Area. But I will say that the blacks and Jews conversation isn't really being had there in the same way that it's being had in New York and Crown Heights and shit like that, because in Oakland, the African American community ruled the roost, and the Jews were just, there was no truly activated Jewish community as far as I was concerned or experienced. Oakland was a city that was ruled by black culture and hip hop culture when I was being raised there. And there were always white people there, and there's a white community, you know, in public schools, like the popular kids were the black kids. And if you wanted to emulate the popular kids, you basically tried to pretend you were black. Or if you were a white kid that just wanted to get into a private school, you would just sort of keep your head down and try to. My brother is one thing. My brother
is a rabbi, right?
He's a rabbi. Yeah. Yeah. And he went to private high school and basically he never kind of fell into the trappings of like trying to make it in that hierarchy of social dynamics, which I tried very hard to make it in, which was basically just a bunch of white kids pretending that they were like the popular kids in school by pretending that they were black.
Yeah, and I want to discuss this with you because I've got a nephew and another nephew and a friend who has a son, and it's very complicated. And again, I'm not going to be an apologist for Donald Trump, but I'm going to be an apologist for Barack Obama, who says, you know, you really have to talk to the other side. You have to understand them. You can't hate them because that's not going to get you anywhere. And so I'm not defending racism or anti-Semitism, but you grew up gravitating to ghetto culture, right?
I guess that's a fair assessment. Sure. Yeah, I mean,
you celebrated and you wanted to be a rapper, and you made your own gang because of methamphetamines. You were using methamphetamines, I guess.
Well, I've done that kind of, I've done speed before, but I wouldn't say that was the primary thing we were doing. We were just, mostly we were a graffiti writing, sort of ne'er-do-well, juvenile delinquent gang of white kids that wanted desperately to be black. I would say that's a more fair characterization.
Okay, so I'm wrong for saying what I'm about to say, but I've said it because I don't think... my friend's son, who's 16, and a couple of my nephews, et cetera, should be acting like rappers. I think they should be in school, not doing drugs. And this is a function of old age and latent conservatism. But I maintain that, as I said earlier, it's stolen valor, and that... celebrating the ghetto as opposed to trying to get out of it can sometimes not be the best use of your time. Is that a fair statement?
Well, I mean, I think it depends on what you are saying is the ghetto and what you're characterizing as the ghetto. I mean, I think that, you know, just as I talked about in that documentary in 13, like whatever the ghetto is and the sort of quote unquote, you know, the prison of the ghetto, not the actual prison, which is connected to the ghetto, but the prison of, you know, poverty and, you know, education that is unavailable at higher levels and fresh produce that's in the ghetto, you know, all that kind of thing that is the actual realpolitik of people who actually live in the ghetto, not people that are emulating that culture. that's all connected to this sort of system of, you know, soft Jim Crow that has been enforced by, you know, the laws and sentencing laws and, you know, gerrymandering and stuff like that. So, you know, what I think people that actually live in black neighborhoods that are disenfranchised and impoverished are starting to rightfully so say, you know what, it's not ghetto, it's our culture, even though we've been, you know, mandated here by a system of poverty that was in, and oppression that was enforced upon us, we celebrate what's in here. We celebrate the beauty that's come out of it. We created hip hop. We created the Black Panthers. We created, you know, all of this like really dynamic culture within this sort of, this heavy framework of oppression. So celebrating that, I think, is kind of beautiful. But, you know, it's interesting, but I understand the point that you're making, which is why would you celebrate being oppressed and impoverished? But, you know, I think the people that are actually in that neighborhood actually don't have another choice but to embrace and love the thing that they are and that, that has come out of it.
What, isn't that what Hasidimism is? I mean, the ghetto is a Jewish, the Italians created the first, the ghetto, it's an Italian word, right?
That's right. I've been to that ghetto. I believe the first one is in Venice, and they would sequester the Jews into a particular neighborhood and close the doors at night, and then in the morning they would open up the doors and allow the Jews out into the streets to go, you know, participate in commerce and make them money, and then come back. You know, the Hasidism is an interesting parallel, because the actual Hasidic Jews of today have created a ghetto, a mental ghetto. Post Holocaust, they've created.
Let me ask you about this, because Hasidism.
Yeah,
it was supposed to be a celebratory. It celebrated the ghetto. It was a very joyous religion at one time. Correct.
Yeah, originally Hasidic Judaism was supposed to be a kind of celebration of the anti-normative form of Judaism. In the, I think, 1600s or 1700s, it was sort of a reaction to the trappings of religion. It was a kind of a Protestant Reformation for Judaism. It didn't end up kind of working out that way. And what it is now is, you know, after the Holocaust, the Hasidic Jews thought to themselves, well, you know what? The world is shit. All these people want to kill us. Why don't we just wall ourselves off mentally and pretend we still live in, you know, medieval Europe, even though we're living in Los Angeles and New York, we'll just live in these neighborhoods, never interact with not. So when you know, to the people that tell me they've met Jews, you know, Hasidic Jews, and they were unfriendly and awful and rude to them, you know, I understand that might be their experience and it might be true for them, but I think they're missing part of the picture, which is, you know, it's a unfriendliness that is due to desperation. And right. I'd say there might be a parallel that's true in the in an African American community for a white person, you know, going in there and saying, why am I being treated as an other? Or why do black people, you know, say white people are the devil? Why do black people constantly talk about how awful white people are? It's like, well, what the hell would you do if you were, mm-hmm. you know, 400 years into your experience here that started with slavery, then it had a nice middle passage of Jim Crow and now has this, you know, cops killing black guys in the street and sending everybody to prison. Well, wouldn't you hate Whitey too? I understand you are a nice white person, but you are not. You, in fact, have made yourself into a monolith, just to come back to the right. idea of the racial monolith. You know, white people made themselves into a monolith by making black people a monolith. So if you think black people are aggressive, well, they think that you are oppressive. And here we are.
Right. Right. By the way, there was a Jew meeting. I'm serious. I know this for a fact, because something happened with the orthos in L.A. about 15 years ago. Uh-huh. And I'd be walking around La Brea and Fairfax, and all of a sudden they'd say hello to they would be friendly. Word came down from, I don't know, Schneerson, some rabbi from the great beyond. Say hello to everybody. Don't be, you know. Were your parents Hasidic or ultra? Yeah, and I've noticed this.
Well, I mean, it all depends, by the way, on what branch of Hasidism you ascribe to. You know, my father happened to fall in with a group of Hasidic Jews that were, luckily enough, the least friendly Hasidic Jews of all of them. And that's really saying something. As I say in my stand-up act, I say, you know, think about this, you know, of all the, you know, the bearded Amish penguin looking folk you've seen on film and TV, my father joined up with a group of them that is the most outside the margins of society. This would be like being among the fattest of all Walmart shoppers. It's very intense.
You were going to become a college professor in Jewish history, I read.
At one point, that was the plan, but then I realized that I didn't really care that much about doing research. I kind of wanted to, it was the same impulse that sent me to being a stand-up. I wanted to sit in front of people and tell stories and talk about it because I'm really fascinated by Jewish history. So anyway, yeah, I mean, my dad married a woman that is from a branch of Hasidic Judaism known as Satmar. And they are definitely the least, I mean, you know, for better or for worse, they are the least friendly of the Hasidic Jewish groups. And that's a particularly unfriendly group of people.
Are they friendly to each other?
They are friendly to each other, definitely. And yeah, sure, I guess. I mean, they're a very intense subsection. Do you know who the Nutre Karta are? Those are the Jews who are anti-Israel Jews, Hasidic Jews. Have you ever heard of these people?
Well, I know that the Orthodox were against the founding of Israel.
So there, yes, and that has held true through to this day. There's an ambivalence about Israel existing outside of the Messianic arrival. That was the idea, is who are you to create Israel? Only the Messiah can create Israel. And there is a small, and loud, a group called the Nutre Karta that actually actively protest the Jewish state, the Israeli state. They marched with the Palestinians. They had like a cabinet seat in Arafat's PLO cabinet, you know. Anyway, those people are a offshoot of the Satmar. So just to show you how kind of fringe they can be, even though Satmar are a pretty big group, they engendered this, you know, pretty out there group of Hasidic Jews. So that is the people that I was lightly raised around.
Do you believe in God?
I don't know. Maybe. Yeah, I'm pretty agnostic. What about you?
Yeah, I do. Do you write G-D or do you write G-O-D?
No, I write G-O-D. I think that's kind of an absurd custom.
Yeah.
It has no actual, even Jewish basis. There's a really interesting book that my dad got me when I was young called The Jewish Book of Why. Do you know about that?
No.
It's a cool book. It's like a 2-volume book that basically asks all the questions about Orthodox Judaism or just Judaism in general. And it's just, but it was written in like 1950. So it's an old school book. And it just says, you know, why don't Jews eat pork? Why did Jews, you know, do this? Why did Jews do that? And then one of the questions in there was, why do Jews write G-D? And I remember that it said, oh, this is like a custom that is based on a superstition that has no actual basis in Jewish, you know, religious law. But it's a passing fad and it will end soon. Well, that guy was wrong. That passing fad became known as sort of a permanent reality. And people think that it's part of the religion of Judaism. It's not. It's based on some kind of interpretation of stuff that's in the religion. But the other day I saw this complete lunatic on Facebook, which is where those people live, that Christian lunatic talking about like transgender people and how gross they are. And this is a Christian, a non-Jewish Christian, but a person that's like connected to, you know, these Christians that are kind of like think that they're connected to Old Testament Judaism. They're like really into that.
They're called evangelicals.
Yeah. And she was writing G-D. So it's like it went from Jews, you know, leaning into unnecessarily, you know, a rule that wasn't even there. So now Christians are doing it, and it's a totally no.
I thought Jews were like not allowed to paint God. You can't worship false idols, and that was the origin of G-D. That saying the word God would be as bad as painting the face of God and worshiping a false idol.
Actually, I think what it is, I could be wrong, but I think what it is that you aren't supposed to destroy the word of God, right?
Right.
And if you write it in Hebrew, you're supposed to like bury a Torah scroll that you're done using because you don't want to burn it or something like that. And then people just like spilled it over into writing it in English. But I don't care about things like that. I like Judaism and I consider myself Jewish, but I don't really have a lot of patience for stuff, you know. What about you? Do you write G-D?
I do. I went to an Orthodox Hebrew school, so It's just real. I'll write G-A-W-D. God. If I'm writing a sketch.
Yeah.
And I have to write God, I'll go G-A-W-D.
Which is actually the most Jewish way you can write it, because it sounds Jewish. God. Oh, my God. It's even more Jewish than
how
you
do,
think.
Deaf parents...
How do deaf people fuck? That's a great question, David, and I'm glad you asked it. I know you don't like the F word, but is it okay on your podcast?
Yes, and you know what? There have been a lot of things. I don't like the F word. Did I give you a hard time about that?
No, I think someone else warned me before I opened for you. Don't say the F word in front of David. He doesn't like that.
So yeah, I don't. I really don't. I think it's lazy and...
Oh, you did give me a hard time. You said... I remember, this is years later after the change your name, you told me, you came up to me and after I just had gotten through doing a set that I think it was maybe in Montreal or something, you were going on later, and you told me, you don't say the F word. And then I just thought to myself, David, I've been doing stand-up at this point, you know, for almost 10 years. Don't you think I've mashed all the mathematic possibilities here? Don't you think at this point it's a deliberate choice that I'm making? But, yes, I say the F word on stage.
And were you, because, you know, what happened was when you started doing stand-up in San Francisco, I had already left. And there was a group of young stand-ups in San Francisco who resented me because they would open for me or they would do guest sets, and I would say, you can't say the F word. I had like my little mini crusade about the F word. What was your reaction to, did you find me being arrogant, old? What was your take?
If I'm being totally honest.
Yeah.
I thought that it was I think that it's an old fashioned modality, and I kind of honor it for that. I think that's kind of cool in a way. I don't necessarily follow the logic because I, from my perspective, like, who care? It doesn't really matter from my perspective if it's would that joke be funny with or without saying fuck? Is like, it's such an old fashioned way of looking at language that it doesn't resonate to me. But I also think it's kind of cool that there are people working that it does resonate with. I know Ryan Stout, for example. I think that he's probably your biggest fan. And starting out, I think, you know Ryan.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, yeah.
And Ryan subscribed to that as well, that, you know, swearing was lazy and it was a crutch. And I think that's cool. I honor the old school idea about vulgarity, but I don't resonate with it because, you know, obviously you're vulgar without swearing. So somebody else would look at your act and think, oh yeah, the guy doesn't swear, but he engages in, you know, every other kind of filth possible. That's lazy. So is that guy right and you're wrong? I don't know. I don't care. I was at doing a college the other day. And I drove in, and I was at a place called John Carroll University, and I said yes to the gig. And then as I was driving in, I was looking at the clock tower, and I was like, uh-oh, that tower is a little too tall. Oh, there's a cross there. Wait, who the hell is John Carroll? No! I'm at a Catholic school. And I literally had a Catholic priest in a frock, no joke, stand up in the middle of my act and say, if you were a great comedian, you'd be able to work clean. And literally a Catholic, it's like a joke, you know, like I have a guy in a frock telling me to work clean. And,
what's wrong with that?
What do you mean? What's wrong with what?
I mean, are you implying that he molests little boys so he has no right to tell you about language?
No.
That a guy who molests boys should not worry about what comes out of his mouth, more what goes into it?
Well, there is that great hypocrisy, which is how could a guy who is affiliated with the Catholic Church ever have anything to say about the naughty and bawdy nature of my language when the system that he's affiliated with literally covered up the rape of little boys? But that's neither here nor there. I just think, like, nothing about vulgarity is resonant to me. I understand immaturity, but it's like, I always think vulgarity is such a funny concept, because the person that is telling you you're vulgar is there only as a result of his father getting horny one night and fucking his mother until he came inside of her, and then came this person who's yelling at you about how vulgar talking about sex is. You know what I'm saying?
Well, like, but my father didn't fuck my mother. He made love to her.
No, that's where you're wrong. I actually... So I think that having rules and strictures about language and subject matter is an interesting idea. And I think it's cool that people care. But why, David Feldman, I will ask you, why are you right about saying the F word on stage, but the person that looks at your act and says, though you're not swearing, you're talking about really disgusting things, that too is a crutch. Why is that person not right as well?
All right. Well, first of all, we're nearing the end. You'll come back?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay.
All right, so I'll answer that.
Or I should say, fucking A, I'll come back. Oh, shit. Hold on, David. I got to...
Is that Natasha?
No, it's a delivery man. Hold on 1 second. I'll be right back.
While we're waiting for Moshe to deal with the delivery man and listen to his dog barking the F word, I believe I'm hearing the F word in Maltese. That is definitely... Oh, and the C word. And the N word. Ah, this is a very vulgar Maltese. But this is the David Feldman Show. And you can subscribe to us on iTunes and follow me on Facebook and friend me on Twitter. And you should pick up Moshe Kasher's book, Kasher in the Rye, The True Tale of a White Boy from Oakland Who Became a Drug Addict, Criminal, Mental Patient, and Then Turned 16. I assume that Moshe has now come back, and your puppy...
I'm back.
Yes, your dog, I speak Maltese, your dog was barking the F word, the C word, and the N word. Did you know that?
You know, I did know that, and that's because I told him I was on your podcast. They aren't fans. I am. I'm a huge fan, but they don't care for what you do.
Okay. Before you go, I'll answer your question, then I have two quick questions. And
yeah.
One of the reasons I don't use the F word, I agree with you, it's an old-fashioned conceit, in that I always said, well, you can't get on TV if you do the F word, so why not tell your jokes without the F word? That way, every time you're on stage, you're testing material to get on network television, and the landscape has changed so that you can now tell jokes with the F word and still get on TV, because they, a lot of networks allow the F word. So that is a function of a different generation. So I agree with you on that. So I'm willing to say, yes, I'm old school because I'm still trying to get on The Tonight Show. And you don't need to get on The Tonight Show to be famous anymore. So that's old school. But I still believe the F word is freighted. I think it's a powerful word. And when you say it, you kind of turn the audience in. It's presumptuous to say the F word in front of strangers, because if you came and met my family, you wouldn't say the F word.
Sure, right.
You wouldn't.
But isn't that that is innately a part of a social contract?
Yes.
And you might have started stand up in a time where the social contract was that you don't say the F word. Actually, I think you started stand up in a time where to do a set you had to get up in front of the cave, in front of the great fire, in front of the cave, and you took the cave bear skull, and that's how you knew it was your time. That's right. No, yes. I'm just kidding. That was a cheap joke. But at that time it was true that to say the F word you were, you know, vulgar and less than. And I think, and like I said, When you met
Natasha's parents.
Yes.
Did you go, hey, how the fuck you doing there?
Yeah, but I think that's a flawed analogy, because I'm not meeting your parents when I'm on stage. I'm coming up and doing a performance for you as the character that I am. And my character is a guy who was raised in, you know, a city or in a culture where saying fuck was like not a big deal. And that's the performance I'm giving over. It's just like, you know, when Frank Sinatra gets on stage and sings a song, he doesn't say fuck, even though he probably does in his personal life. Mm-hmm. But when I go see Snoop Dogg, he's going to talk about fucking girls. And you know what I'm saying? It's just a different. But that said, I don't roll my eyes when you say you know, don't use the F word. I think it's cool. I think that sensibility is cool and good that there are people that are old school and care about that. I just don't.
So before we wrap it up, I'm not going to get into an argument. As much as two Jews talking, we could go 90 minutes arguing over this. And do you know that you ever read the story in Afghanistan that there were two in Kabul, that there were two temples? There were two Jews. I'm not making this up. You probably know about this. You know about the two temples in Kabul?
No.
Look it up. It was the hardest I ever made. I used to work for Bill Maher. The hardest I ever saw him laugh, because his mother was Jewish and his father was Irish Catholic. And I found a story in the New York Times about there were two Jews left in Kabul. And this must have been 2005.
Uh-huh.
And two Jews left in Kabul, two separate temples. They hated each other. They both accused the other one of collaborating with the Taliban. It's one of the funniest stories. And it was on page two of the New York Times. And it just, you know, Jews love an argument. You are the one. I don't want this to sound sexist, but you were the one who got Natasha. am I allowed to say that she is a much coveted human being? And she converted to Judaism and has embraced it. Do you mind if I ask you a personal question?
Sure. She's Jewish. Has it gone downhill?
I'm not going to go for that joke.
Okay, go ahead. What do you got?
But that's a good one. I maintain that Jews could convert to Roman Catholicism. That it wouldn't be that hard for you to become a Catholic, or me to become a Catholic. There's a lot of pomp and circumstances. There's a lot of ridiculousness, inexplicable intellectual papal bulls that come down that require a lot of thinking and loopholes and explanations and hypocrisy, that you and I could find kindred spirits in the Catholic Church. Do you agree?
I do agree. You know, what's funny is, you have you ever tried telling this theory to an actual Catholic?
No.
Because they are, they just don't see, a lapsed Catholic. They just think you're the biggest fool ever for saying, I actually find Mass to be really nice and beautiful. They just go, I think the problem with being Catholic actually is that as beautiful as Mass is, it's the same every single time, and they get really tired of it. Mm-hmm. But I find it kind of beautiful. I've always liked it.
Yeah, we're running out of time, and the gift that Catholics have that Jews don't have is you can really be a self-hating Catholic, and it's celebrated. You know, and nobody's ever said you're a self-hating Catholic. That's not a curse, but if you're called a self-hating Jew, that's like, you know, they're really coming
like
down.
Uncle Tom. So that was your personal question. Do I think Jews could become Catholics easily?
Well, when you were getting married, did it occur to you that maybe since you got Natasha, which is a you got her.
She got me, David.
You won Natasha.
I don't think you understand. She won me. I was the lone wolf.
No.
She's the one that felled the great beast.
I've learned. I've learned. Did it ever occur to you? Was there ever a discussion that Moshe could become
a Roman Catholic?
Or Mark.
I will tell you this.
You go back to Mark.
I got lucky in that Natasha could not have been less affiliated with her Roman Catholic roots. Mm-hmm. And I never asked her particularly to convert, but she was into the idea, if we're going to have a family, of having a family that had some connection to a tradition. So that's why she converted. Also, I forced her to do that as a and that's the other reason. But no, I never considered becoming Catholic. And I do find it a little presumptuous to ask a woman, or for a woman to ask a man, hey, I know you love me, why don't you come into my tradition? So I guess I just got lucky.
She volunteered.
She volunteered. I mean, I know she knows that I'm sure she knew I would not have been disappointed about that, but she volunteered.
Right.
So she is the Jew that would have walked willingly into that oven and said, this is what I signed up for.
My father said to me, don't marry a rich woman. You'll work for every penny.
Uh-huh.
And he said, if you're going to marry, because I did marry out of the religion and had a successful marriage for 30 years until whatever. But my father said, do not make her convert. Don't ask her to convert because you will be in temple for the rest of your life.
Oh, amen. That is true.
Is that true? Is Natasha punishing you by...
No, I happen to not have a lot of trauma when it comes to Judaism, but that is the primary thing about the convert, is that the convert to any religion does not have the historical childhood trauma to go along with their religious experience. So they go, yeah, why wouldn't we just go to temple all the time? Because there's no horrifying memory of being humiliated as a child.
Okay. I've made a decision. We have to wrap it up.
You're going to start saying the F word? That's
no,
so cool.
No, that's I've awesome. Decided. How long have you been doing comedy?
Oh, 13 years maybe.
Oh, you're a man.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah,
I exactly. think you should not change your name.
Thank you.
I'll tell you why I didn't. Well, you did change your name. You were Mark, and you
I
went
know,
to Moshe.
And actually, the bad news is I have changed my name again. It's now Moshe fucking Kasher, so that's what you will.
Before you go, here's the thing. I didn't change my name, and I'm glad I didn't, because I will always have an excuse for never making it.
Perfect. Me too.
Yeah.
We have that in common.
Thank you. I know how busy you are, Moshe Kasher. Your book, which I'm going to finish... I'm ashamed to tell you. I started reading it last night, and I went, "Wow, this guy can write." Kasher in the Rye: The True Tale of a White Boy from Oakland Who Became a Drug Addict, Criminal, Mental Patient, and Then Turned 16. How do people follow you on Twitter and Facebook? And what is your website?
Yeah, you can go to MosheKasher.com at Moshe Kasher. I have a brand new show coming out on Comedy Central this spring. Winter, spring, so it's called Problematic. Check that out.
Great.
And David, thank you for having me on. I admire you greatly.
Well, I admire you greatly. Thank you, sir. Say hello to Natasha for me.
Will do.
Okay.
Talk soon.
Bye.
All right. Bye-bye.
I'm going to tell you about a podcast that I listen to. Two of my friends host it, and I think you should listen to it. Andrew Goldstein, maybe you remember him as my Jew on some of our more popular episodes of the David Feldman Show. Andrew Goldstein is a brilliant comedy writer from MTV and Race Wars. And Matt Goldich writes for Late Night with Seth Meyers, brilliantly funny comedian and comedy writer. They have a new podcast. You can download it on iTunes. It's called Sorry, I've Been So Busy. You know, everyone always says they're so busy, but what exactly are they so busy with? Well, in their podcast, Sorry I've Been So Busy, writer-comedians Matt Goldich and Andrew Goldstein talk to their interesting and funny friends to find out what they've actually been so busy with. Everything from major life and career events to everyday minutiae. Sorry I've Been So Busy is the only podcast that will never blow you off unless something comes up.